Democracy. And he, have I talked to you about his talk?
No.
You know, I know I repeat myself, so you gotta tell me to stop sometimes. He said Brian Stevenson is a lawyer who has spent his life working on death penalty cases in the South. He's now memorializing all the lynching spots in the nation. And he said there are four key principles that are important to him. The first is proximity. Now, how many of you have been to a prison before? Not that many. Is it a requirement of law school that everybody go to prison?
No.
Should it be?
Yes.
So proximity, he says, is really important. You've got to be present to people. And just as you were saying, Sarah, once you meet people, they're no longer monsters. And remember Janet told us, we don't want to call them monsters anyway because that takes away their agency. So proximity is really important. The second is you've got to change from the narrative of fear and anger. You've got to change the narrative. And the narrative is one of fear and anger, Ali, that you got from your compatriots. The third thing is hope, and I think we all came away with a new sense of hope from that. And the final thing is you've got to put yourself in positions where you're uncomfortable in life. You've got to take risks. It takes courage. And it seems to me that we all learn those lessons together. The other comes from so I'm going to give the theologians equal time here with my stories. So this comes from a friend of mine who's a bishop, one of the great bishops, I think, of the Methodist Church. He gave us a talk at Vanderbilt University not too long ago, where he said that the founder of Methodism, a guy named John Wesley, who had this experience at Aldersgate that transformed his life, flooded with grace. He says that he got to Aldersgate through Castle Prison. It was Castle Prison that broke open his heart so that he could receive the Aldersgate experience. And his suggestion was the hope of the United Methodist Church was to get involved with prisons. And one of the things that Steve, I don't think Steve talked about this, Bingaman, who talked in our class, who was at Sing Sing. There's a church, a Presbyterian church in Rye, New York, that became associated with, through Bill Weber's, with Sing Sing. It was a dying church, and now it's one of the most vibrant churches in Connecticut. So there's this, your experience, I think, leads me to say both of those stories are really important. So, tonight we've heard from Janet Connors, who's a great friend of Carolyn's. We've heard from Steve Bingaman, a student here. We've listened to Farouk and the others in the Restorative Justice Task Force talk about criminal justice through different lenses. Tonight we're going to focus on the role of the community. And as all of you expressed in your responses to the readings, you realize the community is at the heart of the restorative justice movement. It's really important. You didn't, and I would highly recommend that all, especially the law school students, read William Stuntz's book, The Collapse of American Criminal Justice. He was the dean of criminal law professors, taught at Harvard, had an untimely death, unfortunately, but he'd be a great conversation partner. But he says that we've got to return our conflicts to the communities where they occur. So community is really important. And I think everybody who, Janet, Steve, Farouk, everybody's expressed the importance of community, and a lot of you mentioned as we talked here. So that's gonna be our focus tonight. I do think there's always something I'd like to say in the beginning is that everybody's having problems with the whole, all of our institutions are having problems with the issue of community these days. So it's not just something shared by the criminal justice system, and it's certainly not something that is unique as a challenge for the restorative justice movement. My friend has done all this work with Kate Prentice. You're gonna hear about this, who says that restorative justice really is about recreating democracy in this country. It's about building community. So we're fortunate to have with us tonight Dr. Carolyn Boyce Watson, who has been studying and teaching and practicing restorative justice for many, many years. One of my mentors did some remarkable work with an organization called WOCA, which is a youth group, youth movement in Chelsea, Massachusetts, wrote a book about it. I think that's where I first got to know you, probably, is around that work you were doing. Has done a lot of work with school systems, is now doing significant work with the Boston school system, and you'll hear about that. Has written a book that, if you're interested at all, and I think probably the most exciting work in regard to restorative justice is being done in schools today, thanks to Carolyn and Kay and others. But this book, Circle Forward, is must reading. And I just learned that 1,000 copies a month are being sold of this book. So this is good for a lot of different reasons. Carolyn's a sociologist who directs the Center of Restorative Justice at Suffolk University. I think that's enough to say, because you're going to get to talk. I have a suggestion. How would you feel if we moved our chairs out just a little bit so our buddies down here can see a little better? And if I know that you might have my back, but you'll get to see Carolyn. Is that okay?
Let's just move out just a little bit.
Okay? So what I'm going to do is interview. And Carolyn said I can ask her anything I want to ask her, and she'll do her best to answer it.
I think so, you came up with this because I said, I don't have any time to prepare anything, but I will show up. It's all interview.
There we go. So what I'm always interested in journeys, and I'd like to start about your journey. I know you talked sociology, you talked criminal justice matters. What was your journey like to restorative justice, your practice of restorative justice? How did that happen?
Well, good evening, everybody. And I just wanted to say, I'm really much more used to, because I do really practice Circle, and have a commitment to the practice of the Circle as a part of restorative justice. So that talking piece going around is the way I'm most comfortable being with everyone. So I really appreciate listening to all of you. I also really appreciate it too, because over the years, I've had, there's been a long history in trying to create that work at Norfolk, many, many years, many false starts. It certainly didn't come from within the prison system. It came from the Lifers group and from community allies supporting them, and for some of the politics to come together in some ways, to move some of the higher-ups to allow this to happen. And it's just, I think several of you said, why aren't there more avenues for inmates to make amends? And, you said, why aren't prisons houses appealing? That is a good question. Why aren't they houses of healing? Why aren't they spaces where people are understood to go there to heal? And those are important questions that we're starting to ask. But for a long time, we weren't asking those questions. So my journey really, we all have journeys, and I would say, it's hard to trace back to what was my journey, in the sense that I think justice for me is probably something that motivated me from a very young age, both sort of for personal reasons, my own experience, and I think given some also identity issues around who I was. And what's interesting is that it led me to both become a sociologist, right? It led me on this journey, which was very interesting because I spent 10 years at Harvard getting my PhD and doing work there. And no one ever asked me at the time, well, why are you here? Why do you want to do this work? Which I think is an insight into how we live with each other all the time. And we really connect with our purpose. of what you talked about, the meaning, purpose and meaning is something we all need, and we all need to connect some of this enormous power of our minds to the power of our hearts. And at least my experience at Harvard was highly cultivating the power of the mind, not a lot of focus on the power of the heart. Of course, you know, I'm looking back on a long journey. So for me, you know, I became an academic and sort of fell into the responsibility of teaching about the criminal justice system. People who were going to go into the criminal justice system, into law enforcement, into probation, people who were going to work in the criminal justice system. And I, at that point, decided that I wanted to be a part of changing the system, not sitting in an ivory tower, not sitting as an academic studying the system, that I had a responsibility to do it, that I wasn't apart from it, that I was complicit in it, in, as a citizen, and also as someone who people came to learn about the criminal justice system, and I wrote books about the criminal justice system, and I just was like, it wasn't good enough for me not to be engaged in some concrete change about the criminal justice system. That led me to get outside of the academy to work on one of the founders of the Criminal Justice Policy Coalition way, 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 way back, and got onto, spent 10 years as the board president of what is now Prisoners' Legal Rights, but at the time was called Mass Correctional Legal System, which was basically the attorneys who defend the rights of incarcerated men and women. So for 10 years I was on the board, the lawyers who represent the rights of men and women in prison here in Massachusetts. Back in the day, there was the BU Prison Education Program, so I taught at Norfolk and I taught at Framingham through that. And but I think some of that experience continued. I really didn't see, I think for me, a real revelation was we heard about something positive happening in Vermont at the time. And Vermont in 1994-95 had set up what they called reparative boards, motivated by the Commissioner of Corrections in Vermont. So in my crusading role to change things, we said, well, let's invite him down and talk about what he's doing. And we would invite all the, you know, we did a forum at Suffolk, and we had all the DAs and the law enforcement and everybody come. And of course, they were like, Vermont, there's cows, there's, you know, Vermont's not not Massachusetts, not Boston, very dismissive. But for me, that opened me up to, I said, well, you know, I really want to understand what he's trying to do. And I read Howard Zaire's Changing Lenses. It was published in 1990. And for me, this is about 5 years or so after it was published. And, you know, that was like the first moment where I really said, okay, I know what I'm doing with my activism. That I am going to work to, because this is a way forward. This is a way forward. It made sense to me intellectually, everything that I knew about how it is people become involved in what we call crime. It made sense to me intellectually about what I knew about how people change. Social science is called desistance or whatever, but how people change. But it also made sense to me at other levels. It made sense to me as a mother. It made sense to me as a human being. It made sense to me as like, this is the way I would handle for the my loved ones. This is what I would want to do with my loved ones. So that was kind of my first step in terms of shifting my activism in terms of engaging with criminal justice. I set out to learn whatever I could. I traveled around going to see what people were doing here. Where were people doing things? And along the way, I had I was giving a talk in Albany at a conference called Justice Without Violence, and I stood up and said, you know, and there's no restorative justice going on in my state of Massachusetts. And afterwards, Barry Stewart, who's a judge from the Yukon, the Chief Justice from the Yukon Territorial Court up in Canada, came up to me and said, actually, I'm coming in about 2 weeks to do a circle training in Western Massachusetts. And I said, you're kidding, for a court in Western Massachusetts? So of course I got in touch with them, and I went to my first circle training. I joined them for this first 4-day circle training. And there were native teachers, and this Western judge, and about 60 court personnel, because at the time, the idea was to use peacemaking circles, or circles, as a way to do sentencing. Sentencing, use them as sentencing circles. So after somebody was convicted, then a process would begin holding circles with the victim's family, holding circles with the offender's family, and then eventually bringing them together, coming to doing the process, out of which would come the decision about what their sentence would be. And in the final circle, the judge would be there, the attorneys would be there, but a lot of work would go on, and these were the model that was being developed at the time from had originally in Canada and had started to spread to Minnesota and then early on to in this one little district court in Orange, in Franklin County and Orange County in the western part of the state. But for me, that first experience in this 4-day circle training, I was pretty convinced halfway through that not just restorative justice, but also these circles had potential for a way forward. So that really shifted my own commitment to what I was gonna put my energies into. By this time, I decided, well, what can I do? I don't know, I can create a center. In fact, remember, I'll create a center to promote. I had no money. Most of the time I've had no money, but I had my time. And I also was really committed. I can say this because I'm at BU, and also I can say it now because I don't know, I'm older, but to giving away the resources of the university. I did not want to serve. I mean, I was a good teacher and I worked hard for the university. I understood that. But what I wanted to do is create something that was going to give it away to the community. And to work with whoever would work with me to start to find a way to make these things happen. So I founded the center in 1997. For a long time, you know, I used to say to people like, oh, the center. I'm like, well, you're kind of looking at the center. But that wasn't really true because there were a lot of people for whom who I engaged with and worked with out in the community. And again, Janet is, for instance, someone who I met her shortly after Joel was killed, and heard her talking about her experience. And so as Tom, we didn't actually meet first through ROCA as much as we worked on the first conference that we did in 1999, where we brought all these people. We brought everybody under the sun. We brought Howard Zaire, mm-hmm. Kay Prannis,
Barry
Stewart from the Yukon. I don't know what we were thinking. I mean, just like, you know, this all-star people for 3 days here to Boston for a 3-day conference. And I don't know if you remember, but do you remember Michael Hoogsteen? Mm-hmm. Kathy Hoogsteen? Mm-hmm. He just called me today. Mm-hmm. 18 years ago, right? And a man who he had called me just before that, just as we were doing all the planning of the conference, he called me and he said, he was down in North Carolina, he said, I've heard about what you're doing up there. I'd like to come and speak at your conference. My wife would like to come and speak at your conference because my wife just went through this experience and she wants to speak at your conference. And I said, okay. So his wife had been shot by a 13-year-old boy, wow. Shot in the head, and she survived. Mm. And they they were charging the 13-year-old with as an adult. And she desperately didn't want that to happen. And the DA wouldn't, you know, would not listen at all to her wishes. And they've had an amazing journey. But they came up and spoke at that conference, and 18 years later, he just called me and wants to know who else is doing restorative justice and how can they engage in it here in Western Mass. And they want to know, is anything happening in the schools? And I was like, that's where everything's happening in the schools right now. So the first thing I did was work at that conference. I had really asked this organization, ROCA, because I really admired ROCA. ROCA was a youth development organization in Chelsea at the time, and Chelsea and Revere. And it was a community-based organization that never gave up on kids. And I heard them talk at a conference, and I was like, that makes sense to me. Like, I would never give up on my kids. Like, there was no, it was unconditional. They would never give up on a kid. So I knew the director of that, and I came back from the circle training, and I said, you gotta come to this conference, because there'd be circles. And, you know, I could feel like everybody was looking at me like I had, like, you know, like, I'm sure you had a lovely experience there, Callan. I sounded, you know, she was sort of glazing over, and I realized what I must sound like talking about these circles, but I'm like, just come to this conference. Just come and bring whoever you want. So they came with 15 of them, 15 young people. They're noisy. You know, they came and they're rowdy, and they saw these circles and they were like, this is what we need. This is what we need is to do these circles. So within a month, they had brought Barry Stewart back from the Yukon, all these people back, and that started a journey for me working with them on how to really embrace these circles with young people from the street, not anything through the systems, but with where young people would sit in these circles. And that was, for me, such a powerful experience, realizing that to sit for 4 days with young people who had, you know, they'd blown out of school. They did not sit with adults. And we sat for 4 days, all day long, speaking people's truths and from the heart. And I spent about 5 or 6 years working with them, and then eventually wrote a book about the power of these circles. Which, to me, to some extent, tell us, the power of the circle tells us how, it tells a lot about how we're living when we're not in the circle. It tells a lot about what we're doing every day, because I'm always going, this is kind of simple. We rearrange the furniture, but we're all face to face. We generally use not just a set of keys, but something a little richer than that. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's pretty simple and so powerful, so powerful. So I'm saying, so what is this telling us about how we're living otherwise? That something as simple as having everybody be able to be seen and heard, everybody feeling that they have a place, everybody feeling that they actually really, it matters what they say. How are we living otherwise? How are we living every day, all the time, with all the resources that we pour into, you know, every one of those kids? They have caseworkers, they have social workers, they have all kinds of people who are assigned to them, and they feel like nobody hears them, nobody listens to them, nobody talks to them, and they're not heard or seen. And we did circles, I'll tell you, one of the things that really blew me away one time was a Superior Court judge. You probably remember him, what was his name? Because I don't know all the judges, but you would get
The guy out in Western Mass was Tom Meredith.
No, not Tom, but okay. It was a Superior Court judge, and we were sitting in a, he was talking, we were in circle, and he was talking about why he thinks circles are so powerful. And he said in that circle, he says, I don't feel like I'm ever heard than when I'm in circle. And I nearly fell off my chair. I'm like, you're a big, important judge. Everybody listens to you, you know.
Absolutely.
The whole room goes quiet when you talk. But he meant nobody sees him.
Yeah.
He says nobody sees me. He's in his role as a judge, but he doesn't see, he's not seen and heard outside. So we started doing this for, we did this in DYS. One of the first circles I did down at Rocha was, got this idea. There was a lot of conflict with, they were largely Cambodian youth. And we did a police youth circle, and I was keeping that circle. You know, and the police all came in uniform, and they're all lined up on one side, the youth were all lined up on the other side, kind of, you know, we're in a circle, but they kind of, like, divided, you know, and there's like, pass. You know, and eventually, you know, there was a space for talking about, you know, how they feel, how the police feel when they walk in, you know, kind of into a park late at night, and how they're worried about getting home at night to see their kids. And, you know, for the youth, talking about what it feels like to be stopped by the police and have a gun put to their head. Mm-hmm. And then to have the police say, oh, okay, oops, it wasn't you. You know, and them not knowing, you know. And I was struck by how far we have to go for those experiences to really be exchanging, for there to be empathy across these roles that we have. But that work was, again, with Rocha, was just the start of, for me, a real commitment to circle. And we then have kind of not looked back since then, or I haven't, in developing the work in schools. And the schools have largely grown, the schoolwork have largely grown out of kind of a much more, in some ways, political agenda around the school to prison pipeline, mm-hmm. and the naming of that. So there's been a lot of development kind of post Michelle Alexander's book to kind of name what a lot of us knew all along, that the criminal justice system is deep, not just incidentally racist, but has a racist origins. I think the victims' rights movement really played into so much of this, about how unhealed victims are through what the criminal justice system did, how many unmet needs there were. Obviously, those of us who had been engaged in prisons for a long time were aware of the destructive nature of prisons, the intentionally destructive nature of prisons in some ways. You talked about Norfolk's architecture. You know, the history of prison is really that there's all these lofty aspirations for what prisons can be, and then the reality has been something else, including Norfolk, always. Because it was one of the early ideas of creating kind of, it looks sort of like a college campus, but it's not. And, you know, it's interesting for you to hear, for me to hear, there's a lot of volunteers there. You know, there was a long period here in Massachusetts where it was, you know, the DOC was very committed to keeping people out of from coming inside prisons. It was no news, no riots, no news, no escapes, no deaths. That's it. And no outsiders. So, you know, there's been different regimes in terms of this. Like, climate is different now. There's more. The tide hopefully turned around all of the things that drove mass incarceration up. But all these years that we were doing this was the time of the Get Tough rise and all of the policies put in place on the war on drugs and sentencing policies, and also the mindset that of zero tolerance. And so that criminal mindset that was in the fueling kind of mass incarceration slipped right into the schools. And really gave rise to then, you know, this so-called idea of zero tolerance that, you know, starting in the mid-2000s, people started to really, because there was such schools invested so heavily in zero tolerance where the rate of suspensions and expulsions just went through the roof. Very different pattern than had existed for generations prior to that. And then people started looking at the outcomes from zero tolerance. And surprise, surprise, suspensions didn't change behavior for the better, tended to make the behavior worse. It didn't make the school safer for students who weren't suspended. That was a surprise to people. And schools who didn't invest in zero tolerance were doing much better academically than schools that had invested in zero tolerance. So there was a lot of really good data that came out about it to really investigate whether or not it was doing what people thought it was doing, and also the idea that it was doing tremendous harm, and the racial disparities in suspensions and expulsions were really kind of raised as a civil rights issue, and a lot of activism around that. So restorative justice has really gone furthest and fastest in schools, where schools at least have a foundation of saying that they are there in as a positive institution, where the criminal justice system is a much, and schools are natural communities, nested within communities, but they are by themselves natural communities. But the criminal justice system, I mean, prisons are communities as well, as you acknowledge. I mean, they're very, they have a sort of stability of people constantly interacting with each other. Schools have become a place where the work can go much further. So a lot of our stuff has been working schools. And I really would prefer, and you can ask me more questions, but I'd love to invite questions,
yes,
or comments or thoughts or, and so on.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Jonathan.
Well, you mentioned the 90s, and they mentioned 8 Block at the 90s and 8 Block at Norfolk.
Yeah.
And I couldn't help but think, here's this building to enshrine mass incarceration in a place that was designed to do something different. And so you're trying to instill this sort of environment at a place that was intentionally created to be different. And so it was kind of weird, and it seemed out of place. And it functions in a way exactly how you would think it would, to segregate, to sort of punish prisoners that are there. And so it reeks of this idea that incarceration has to be ugly and has to dehumanize in a large sense. So I thought that was very interesting. I want to get your feelings about some of the ways that we have continued to build prisons in ways that dehumanize, even though we've had this rise of consciousness around mass incarceration.
A crack in the consciousness.
Yes.
Yeah, we're a long way. I mean, we're still, the prison industrial complex is alive and well. We have a lot of work. We are working very much right now in Connecticut, the state of Connecticut, in their juvenile detention facilities. And and unlike, what's gone on in Norfolk, our opportunity is there. We're working, for instance, very recently now in a facility that is an adult correctional facility but has 2 units that house 14 to 21-year-olds who were all waived into adult court, and so they are going to serve adult sentences eventually, but right now they have to be housed by federal law separately from adults. And of course they call it the Manson Youth Institute. There's nothing Youth Institute about it. It's just 2 units in the prison that house these young boys, basically. And we work with the correctional officers and the staff and the youth, and we bring in circles they started bringing us in to do, you know, we wanted, it started as a project to focus on reducing disparities in the juvenile system for DMC. Does everybody know what I mean when I say DMC? Disproportionate minority contact, or DMC, disproportionate minority confinement. But now they define it as DMC, as disproportionate minority contact with the criminal justice system at any point, whether it's police or whether you get sentenced or whether you're getting locked up more. And they found in Connecticut that a lot of the kids would get inside a facility and they would pick up arrest charges inside the facility and getting them deeper. And a lot of that was staff to youth assault, like youth would assault the staff and those kinds of things that would happen inside the facility. So they brought us in saying, let's do restorative justice there by doing an alternative process when they got into a conflict, when an incident happened. And we said, nope, we're gonna have to start by sitting in a circle. We're gonna teach you how to sit in a circle together. Mm-hmm. That's what we're gonna do. And we're like, that's what we do. And we will also teach you how to respond differently using a restorative practice when incidents do happen. But you're gonna start by sitting in a circle together and learning the circle practice. And being in circle, you as a guard and you as a young person, and being together in that space, which is very psychologically very different from how the prison conditions people to have to look at the inmates through a certain lens. Because that's what the institution does. You know, I'm sure you're all familiar with, you know, the Zimbardo, the Stanford prison experiments and so on. I mean, the circle is something that helps us, as Kay Prana says, step in the direction of our best self. The circle is a space that in some ways, you know, allows us to see one another as human beings. Prisons are the opposite of that in the sense that they very much structure people's experiences to see each other through a certain kinds of lens. And it's very difficult to hold that, to do that job. It's difficult to do that job. Because I'm working with these people, and some of them, it's too hard to go there, and some of them sit with that ambiguity. Some of them walk in there and they see these kids and they go, those look like my kids. And if somebody looks like your children and you're feeling like that could be my son, it's a hard place to be in, because you're not asked to care about them, and you're not asked, in fact, you're really, there's something called undue familiarity, which is hung on words too about undoing familiarity, right? It's designed to say, do not be familiar, do not cross those lines, because then you won't, you know, and it's couched in, they're going to con you, everybody's, you know, inmates are a con, and they're going to try to manipulate you and all that. But it's a very, one of the things about restorative justice is it recognizes that none of us are defined by any one of our actions. All of us are capable of good, all of us are capable of not, of doing harm. That's the human condition. So, we have built, in some ways, institutions and the mindset that is underneath the institution around ideas about good guys and bad guys. Around there's evil people. And that, in some ways, gives us permission to do things we wouldn't normally do otherwise. And we ask other people to do the dirty work of this. Prisons are out of sight and out of mind for a reason. Because we're asking those other people to do that for a living. And I would say, for correctional, you know, we do this, we say, you know, listen, correctional guards are doing life on the installment plan. They're just doing it in 8-hour shifts. And, you know, I remember once very much being so moved, and I say this with trepidation in some ways, by a student who said to me, in my own restorative justice graduate class, and she said, you know, my father was a correctional officer his whole career, and, you know, it's only once he retired that my mom felt she got her husband back, and I felt like I got a father. But we missed him all those years. So it's not, and that's not on them, that's also on all the rest of us. That's how I feel about it, and so that's how I feel like I fulfill my responsibility to say, it's not enough for me to be critiquing it. And nor is it enough for me to demonizing, oh, those terrible correctional officers, they're not. You know, that's the job they've been put there to do. And if we're gonna shift, we have to engage with everybody to figure out how to make this shift. So I don't know if that really addressed what you're saying, but I think it's, you know, there is, I mean, the proximity issue is really interesting. If we isolate, prisons isolate people, and that allows us to, in some ways, create an empathetic break. So I'll give you one thing, I'll just share this one thing. When I first, my very first RJ training at that time in the 90s, Janet Reno invested a lot of money in federal money. At that time there was federal money through OJJDP and the National Institute of Corrections for Restorative Justice under Janet Reno. All that money went away when she left, but there was a period of time. And one of the first big trainings was people came from all over the country, a cohort of us of about 30 people, and for 10 days we trained to then go back to our respective states and to train in all the restorative practices. And in my cohort was a juvenile prosecutor from Illinois. And I'll never forget, he said, and he stood up and he said, you know, if I thought of the people that I prosecute as real people like my own family, I couldn't do my job. And I was like blown away by that. Because of course I knew from the other side, that's how allows people to offend against other people, the sort of criminalization where you like dehumanize the victim, allows you to do harm to them. But then we ask prosecutors and everybody on in the criminal justice system to do this job of prosecuting, and they have to create an empathetic break in order to do their job. They can't humanize the people that they're with because they've been asked to do a certain. But this is institutionalized. It's not about the people, it's about the institution that's cultivating. So if we're gonna shift, we have to come back to the people. The hearts and minds, the hearts that are in the people. And start from there. And start from there to see each other. And I know you all went and listened to people who are incarcerated, and you know, they're people. And in some ways, they've been stripped bare and done some amazing, beautiful work inside of prisons, because they don't get a lot, whoever said, you know, they deal with stuff that's on the outside, we can sometimes look the other way. But, you know, nobody, people inside prison, you know, you can be inside a prison and still avoid your, you can use, you can go your whole life inside a prison and not do this hard work of healing and coming to terms too. But you generally do it in spite of the prison and not because of the prison. The prison does not open those doors for people. They fight to heal themselves inside the prisons, because prisons aren't designed as houses of healing. They could be, but they aren't.
You had, can I just
Sure.
A couple of questions about community bond, and so you introduced me to Nils Christie and his work on conflictless property. And how our conflicts, and you've been saying that, how they've been stolen from us. And, you know, a prosecutor handles 95% of all cases. Prisons are way off. We're not in sight. How do we reclaim our conflicts? How do we restore those conflicts where we have proximity to them, we are involved with them, and we create community around them?
I'm being a little, I mean, obviously I've been thinking about this a lot, but, you know, so So one of the things that I would say, that we need a lot of wisdom and not expertise. Mm-hmm. You're coming to me like I'm an expert, I don't know. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure that we have to do this. We have to create spaces where we gather the wisdom of people who are most affected by everything that's going on and who are the direct. So let me say this. I did this. I went down to Brazil. Brazil's doing a lot of great restorative work. They published our book in Portuguese and our previous book in Portuguese, and there's all kinds of amazing stuff going on down there. And I did a tour, like a speaking tour down there. And the title of my talk was Justice is Not a Spectator Sport. It didn't go well, it didn't translate well into Portuguese, and it was a bit hard, but I have an American audience here, so I can kind of use that metaphor again. Because justice is something that you, the people who are actually affected on both sides are the ones who need to do justice together. It's not something you can delegate. So it's like love, friendship. You can't delegate it, but you go like, do my friendships for me. And it doesn't work that way. Because justice is transformative in the interaction between people. And we are biologically designed to reconcile. Otherwise, we would have died out a long time ago. Because we bump elbows with each other all the time, because we're also biologically designed to have autonomy and drive, which kind of means sometimes we like to, you know, dominate other people for our own will. But guess what? Other people are like, hey, yeah, not so fast. That's kind of rolling over me, right? I mean, this is what we do all the time in community. Otherwise, communities would self-destruct. We need to bond. We need to come together. We need to have collective action. And we are fundamentally social, but we're also fundamentally kind of autonomous. And that's a paradox. And so justice is in some ways something we're really designed to do. And restorative justice, that's why we bring people together face to face. And why the power of telling stories face to face has a power to shift the where people are when they're in, to take somebody from a state of injustice to a state of justice. And someone else can't really do it for them. So we leave, because we've got a mindset that justice is can be handled by professionals and we turn it over to the justice system, it leaves victims unhealed. It leaves offenders, you know, unaware of like the impact that they had, and also in some ways detached from their own moral nature. We have also a moral nature. We do. And we activate that in relationship with each other. And we now have a system that deactivates it all the time. And something else is going on when we do that kind of criminal justice. It's not the justice that transforms, that's transformed. So, and that's, you know, and that's Niels Christie's point, among others. I mean, he's also saying that what conflict, well, they all read it. Mm-hmm. So what did you all get from Niels Christie's strange little article written in 1977?
Uh-oh. I got the idea of having a midwife. You know, we have midwives for birth. Somehow having restorative justice practitioners trained to work with district attorneys as a midwife to try to integrate restorative justice processes more in the criminal justice system. And that's what he talked about in his article, was more localized practitioners and to just raise up a cadre of midwives of restorative justice. That was the image I got from this piece.
Midwives, that's interesting metaphor.
Yeah, it is. Rebirth.
Oh, you had a question.
I understand that Norfolk is not ideal in lots of ways, but clearly there are some good things happening there. Is it possible to replicate that, and what would it take to replicate that?
Well, I would say to replicate it, you'd have to understand what, you know, what went into that. And, you know, there's a lot of really good work going on inside of prisons all across the country, not just at NOCA. I think that to some extent it involves, you know, it really does involve people from the outside partnering with people on the inside. But the pressure for what happened at Norfolk came a lot from people on the outside, because the lifers on the inside were trying to no avail for many, 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 many years to get something going there. And it took some of the stuff from the outside, and they actually modeled it after some stuff going on in Pennsylvania and those reconciliation days that spread to there, and then a whole lot of like politicians came to those, those reconciliation days. Did they talk about all that? Days of reconciliation?
Responsibility retreats.
Yes.
The way they described it.
You know, and Janet's been, you know, sort of victims also were really prominent in pushing some of that, which I think probably put pressure on the prison administration to allow more to happen there. So, you know, I guess I feel very much that that we as citizens need to put pressures on we need to engage with our, you know, these institutions that, again, are placed out of our, if you don't have a loved one behind the wall, it's easy to live your life not aware that this world exists in our midst. And that's not incidental, that's intentional in a lot of ways, and I think that there's a lot of shame around also incarceration, and and also shame around victimization that has, continues, where there's a lot of silence around it. So I think, we have a lot of people, a lot of times, you know, students have come up to me outside of class to tell me that they've got a parent in prison or a brother in prison. Because it's not this is something that is in some ways very much hidden within our society, and it's a source of a lot of shame for people. And we don't take responsibility for having built an extraordinarily, what we've created. Mass incarceration is also concentrated incarceration. You know, it's a massive system concentrating in very small communities and neighborhoods. So it's extreme. So people from people from outside those communities are also in some ways insulated from what we are, but we are responsible. We need, I believe, to take responsibility for it. I know you had a question earlier.
Yeah, this is a little bit of a half-baked question, but I had a curiosity about how easy it is to use substances in prison, and just all the different illegal behaviors that happen inside prison, and abuse between inmates and also between guards and inmates. And I'm just wondering if this is kind of like a question for the researcher in you about if there's been research done to like the magnitude of that problem, and if so, if like exposing that in a meaningful way might help to further the cause of restorative justice, if people knew more that prison is not like a safe environment for anyone who's in there, if that makes sense. Or it just gets back to it doesn't matter because they did a crime, so it doesn't matter what happens to them.
I'm not sure what would, one of the things that I always say about, like the war on drugs, prisons are, you all just went into, actually, it's, very few of the prisons look like Norfolk as well. Many of them are much more, you know, locked down. And, but you know what it is to just get inside, right? So if we can't keep it outside of those environments, which we can, anybody who wants to use can use inside a prison. So there's just as much of a drug trade inside a prison as there is out on the streets. So it just really goes to show the sort of the futility of trying to, you know, restrict, do what we're trying to do. I think this has been known in the research community for a long time. It's not known in the political consciousness and in our politics. Mm-hmm. So there is a big gap. I mean, Michelle Alexander's book didn't say anything new. She's really using existing research to make, to, but she punched through kind of a silence around certain things that was only in the research community and the academic community to make it much more, you know, to state things very clearly and assertively that, you know, and to really name this as the civil rights issue of our time. And I think that in a lot of ways, to me, what I see going on is restorative justice is becoming part of a sort of a rebirth of the civil rights agenda, and it's being really taken up around the civil rights agenda as well, which I think is very hopeful. And in a lot of ways, people of color are coming to the forefront and leading the restorative justice movement, fueled a lot by the activism around the school to prison pipeline and mass incarceration, and seeing this also in terms of racial equity. And I think all of this is that, and also indigenous rights, and those, that to me is very hopeful. I don't know if that doesn't really answer your question, but.
Mm-hmm. And Ellie.
I just have a question. You have mentioned that, or talked about lifers kind of petitioning for restorative justice programs, and I'm wondering if you've seen a similar desire from offenders who are serving shorter sentences, and if not, if you think that that's the reason that, you know, my classmates were speaking up about before, that they can't replicate this type of culture that they have at MCI Norfolk and other prisons. Like, in other words, is the restorative justice practice less effective if imposed on people, as opposed to if it kind of comes from within people making a conscious choice to participate? Sorry, that was a lot of answers.
Yeah. Well, you know, look, I think that the will to make prisons spaces for genuine healing is a will that has, that comes from not the, it's not about the inmates. It's the choice of the larger society and the larger culture. Because people who are coming in for short stints actually could really do so much in using that time constructively with short stints. I mean, the Europeans don't lock people up for life. You do commit the same crime in Europe and you get a 12-year sentence, which they consider it a really long sentence. Because they are always oriented towards coming down and coming out better. And many years ago, you know, Hampton County Correctional Facility, So I went out there years and years ago on my, like, activism, you know, when I was around that time of being more activist, and they had a lower recidivism rate than any other institution. And one of the things that was going on there was, first of all, they had a sheriff who said, he said, I never used the term rehabilitation. Because remember, during this whole time, rehabilitation came like you know, people said they didn't believe in rehabilitation anymore. But he said, you know, he asked the community, do you want people to come out better than when they come in? And he said, everybody said, yeah, I do. And so what he did was he actually put and had the whole facility, in most correctional facilities, there's a tension between so-called treatment and the security staff. And he put the treatment people in charge of the security staff, and also said how the security staff part of the treatment team. So they were all part of saying, every person who comes in here is going to do something so that they can come out better than when they came in. And I'm going to be part of that. And they like their job way better. And they got trained and they were part of the team. And it was pretty amazing. And I had the same question that you had, which is, how come everybody doesn't replicate this? So the politics of it are really, like, understanding that is really the crux of it, is what's our will? And where is the will? Because the possibility is not hard. I mean, this is, in fact, it's probably way, it's not money. I mean, the most of the cost in prisons is security. That's very costly. And we spend a tiny amount on programs, really, a fraction of the budget. Hovering around like less than 5%, even probably less than 3%. So that, that's a puzzle, and I'm interested to hear your thoughts about that puzzle. But I think in some ways, this work about at the community, we have to really kind of shift where we're thinking about where the energy comes from to create change. And it comes from, I think, out in the community.
So back to schools a little bit as the pipeline. So I had an experience as an intern in the public school system not too many years ago, where I was working with a teacher who had, and I was teaching a class that was what they called the college prep class, was essentially, you know, I don't know, a C-level class, a class where they didn't necessarily think these kids would go to college. And she was working with advanced placement kids. My class was significantly larger than the advanced placement. And at one point, also a lot more diverse, as you can imagine, and kids from homeless shelters, kids with very difficult family life. At one point, I had said to her, I would like, it was an English class, I would like to put the kids in a circle. And she unequivocally said no. She said, absolutely, you cannot put them in a circle because they will go berserk. You can't do it. You can't allow them to be vulnerable. You can't allow them to talk to each other in that way because it will cause havoc and blah, blah, blah. You won't be able to control it. So that experience, and then another experience of being in other classrooms where I was working with, you know, the kids who were, I don't even know what they call them because they have them all tiered, who were clearly coerced to be there, because if they weren't there, they were going to go to jail. So, you know, you have kids smelling like pot, and they really don't want to be there, absolutely forced to be there. So I guess I felt in a way like I was a guard, like I wasn't a teacher so much as I was a guard. And that also when you had no opportunity to really develop a community among your students because it was these little classes that went out and you were only with them for a third of the year. And I decided not to go into teaching, partly because I just really I did not come out of the public school system until sort of really at the very end. So it's not something that's I accept easily. So this was actually in a relatively, you know, more of a rural, but, you know, middle class. It was not in an urban, quote-unquote, neighborhood. But just to see the disparity in the way that we treated people, and also in the fact that there was complaints from the teachers that these kids didn't work hard, and what they were doing was working 30 hours a week at Target just to make sure their mother could pay the rent. And so I guess my question is, it may not have been appropriate for me to put them in a circle, or it may have because I was an older teacher and it's possible it would have been fine. But just that attitude within the school, it does set though. It like I felt like I was absolutely in a system that was setting those kids up 100% to fail.
Yeah, well, school's prison pipeline
right.
is real.
Exactly.
It's not
and
just
so
a
I
metaphor.
Just so I
it's
guess
more
my,
than a metaphor.
So my question is. We can do we can pull kids out of classrooms, we can, you know, put them into circles, but we still have this systemic structure that is creating this pipeline how do you go beyond a program and really get into the foundational structure of this thing that is supposed to be nurturing humanity, when and instead it's making them feel inhuman and like little widgets and coerced and so what do we do
so
with
that,
the system?
So largely our work right now, and has been since 2005, most of the work of the center has been in schools.
Mm-hmm.
We right now just got a $3 million grant from the funded by National Institute of Justice to do a, we are not the researchers, there is a research team. We're doing a randomized controlled trial. We'll be working with 30 schools in the Boston Public Schools for 3 years, 15 and 15. But we've been working with tons of schools and and continue to work with lots of other schools in addition to this particular project. And what we really do is we start with starting to put the staff in. The staff just sit in circle. So I'll tell you, so in Open, California, this is another school district, it's not dissimilar city to Boston in some ways, in terms of its urban quality and a lot of the issues going on. They were one of the school districts that really embraced restorative justice, particularly using circles and a lot of our work. And the first school that they started using it was a middle school in 2005, Cole Middle School. And the first thing they did that first year was all they did was have circles with the staff, once a week circles with the staff, where staff came together and just talked in circle about, you know, their own struggles, who each of them are, they got to be connect with each other. You know, they didn't talk about even suspensions, expulsions. The end of that year, suspensions had dropped 80% in that school. So you tell me what's going on. So why do you think that is? I mean, I'm just really curious. Like, why do you think that is? I mean, I have my own thoughts about why that is, but I'm curious what you think. Nothing. Kids didn't change at all. They were not involved in this at all. The adults changed. Usually when I go into a school, they invite us in to change, to work with the kids. They're like, the kids. I'm like, all right, you know, we're really here to change the adults. I don't tell them that because I think I'm not going to get asked back if I do that. Nobody wants to be changed. But when the adults change, the kids change too, because it is an environment in which, you know, they're not being honored and invited and held. Their needs are not being met, and they have a need for meaning and purpose. They have a need to talk about the truth. They have a need to talk about what they know and what they see and what they understand. And they need the adults to step up and talk about what's going on in their lives and everything. And we don't. We just don't. We pretend like, you know, and they're like, they're checked out, you know. Yeah. So anyway, I'm just curious what you all think, like what was going on. Because it was really fascinating and we continued kind of to build on that.
You get the last word, Nashnik, before the break.
I guess I have a kind of a two-part. I think, like, to answer your question, I think what's going on is that there's, like, some type of connection with, like, the circle process and the restorative justice process that gets at or realigns people's core self.
Mm-hmm.
I think that has something to do with it. And then my question for you is that, so you said justice is transformative, and I immediately thought of health and wellness for some reason. I don't know, maybe because the words go together so well. And I wanted to know, like, in your work with restorative justice, have you seen, like, a positive change or impact in the people who are in prisons, like mental health or well-being, and the communities, mental health and well-being in some type of way?
I mean, I don't do a lot of the prison work, so I'm not sure what you know, exactly what your question is, but I would say, I think of, circle is a practice that I would consider it a wellness practice. It's a wellness practice for communities. It's a community building practice, but it's a wellness practice for individuals as well. It's a slowing down. It's a bit like mindfulness. And it is a spiritual practice. And it's also one that actually really starts to, it shifts how people see one another, you know. So there's huge amounts of prevention there. So I'll tell a quick story too. When we first school we ever started working with here in Boston, also in 2005, was Charlestown High School, where they had come to a talk presentation we'd done. And if you know the school system and choice at Charlestown, in Boston at the time, it was the school that like nobody chose. You got assigned there because your parents never chose anything. So it was really, in some ways, and it's got a long history of Charlestown as a place. It was a rough place, and they were divided into four separate units. They were divided into four equal units. And this one dean of one unit called and said, you know what, Carolyn, I have no money, I have no time, but I can't have a year like last year. I'm picking up clumps of hair off the floor of girls who get in fights. Like clumps of hair off the floor from the fights. We can't have a year like last year, can you help us? And I said, sure, we'll come in. And we started just holding circles. I said, don't make any teacher be there who doesn't want to be there. Any teacher who wants to be there, that's fine. Just started holding circles with some teachers who were interested. They started bringing it into their classroom. The kids started saying to other teachers, well, how come why aren't we doing circle in this classroom? Why aren't we doing circle in that classroom? You know, the kids were like, I really like this. So they came back to me after that year and they're like, we want to do something where next year, we want to have every ninth grade girl who comes into our unit gets in a circle once a week with other girls. And there was no advisory there. They had no, their only electives were ROTC and gym. So we figured out how to like create a little space. Gym teacher was delighted because none of these girls like gym anyway. And so they're like, yay, who cares? They don't have to come. We created a space where for the first 2 months of the year, we did these small circles of like 10 girls. We trained up older girls. We trained up juniors. They were freshmen, ninth graders. And we trained up junior girls and female teachers. And they were just talking circles once a week. And these girls were like, at first, they wrote on their evaluation, you know, I don't do girls. I don't get on with girls. I don't like girls, but I like my girls in my circle, right? And they were like, or some of them would say things like, you know, at first, this was so stupid. And I was never going to talk. No one's going to make me talk. And now it's the only reason to come to school, you know, at the end of the 2 months. The end of that year, the school calls me and they say, this is the first year we've had no fights just in that unit. No fights. A couple shouting matches, but no out and out fights. Okay? And they said, whatever you're doing in there with circles, in this unit that's using circles, their attendance is higher. Their suspensions are lower. Like, we were doing nothing around conflict. We were just introducing circle. So there's a kind of prevention that it shifts the relationship between the kids. Because they get, it's, and a lot of it is social emotional learning around, I remember a student, I took her to a group at Leslie who was interested that we were doing circles. And you know, these were not the good kids either. You know, it's kind of challenging to take them out of school for the day. Disappeared on me at one point. I was like, but you know, and they were not prepped for this group of adults who were asking them about what school, you know, why do you like these circles? And I didn't know what they were going to say. And I remember this girl said, you know, I realize when I'm in these circles that I'm pissed off. I'm so pissed off all the time. And I come in school every day and I'm pissed off. And then I act on that. And I get in trouble, and I'm blowing my life up. And I can't do that. You know, my life's going down the tubes. You know, I get, and the issue about dealing with the rage and the hurt and all the things we know are chronic in the lives of young people, poor young people, largely of color, coming into school in a space that is triggering and doesn't invite anything for them, any space for them, they, the emotions are driving them, they get triggered and that like they get into conflict with teachers all the time, and it's their future that goes down the tubes in this way. And they know it if we can slow down and create a little space for them to start to hear themselves, to connect, and have the adults start to shift too and see them. And then it takes a lot of courage on the part of the adults. A lot of these teachers, a lot of teachers are white, a lot of teachers are very uncomfortable with this space, so we try to really create their comfort level in being in this space. Sometimes they're like, no, too much emotion. I'm like, the emotion's already here. It's already here. It's like, you know, they're like, we can't open up those emotions. I'm like, what do you think the clumps of hair out on the floor of the hallway are? You know, a kid blows up, you look at them the wrong way and they blow up. There's stuff going on, and we have got to create, you know, I think that the opening now around social emotional learning has given more language around understanding in schools. This has been another way in which we've been able to bring it into schools, because all the schools understand they need to really do things around social emotional learning. And I say, no, they think it's just about the kids. The adults need a whole boatload of social emotional learning. That's what I think happened in the Cole Middle School, that the adults became more aware of their own feelings, more aware of their own reactions. They became less reactive, more aware of what they really want to do as teachers, more aware of how they really want to behave. And then they could have a space to see that it's really consequential when they kick a kid out of the classroom, when they send them to, when they suspend them. You know, it's really real. Like, just two suspensions, you know, one suspension in the ninth grade doubles the likelihood that a kid is going to drop out. Mm-hmm. One suspension. You know, it's very consequential, that behavior. And adults need to understand the implications of their behavior in the life of the young people. The adult's okay. The young person is not, when there's conflict between an adult and a young person in the school. So I think helping adults slow down, get the support they need, not be demonized. We can't go around demonizing one side or the other, which is kind of what we do in a very adversarial framework, which is largely the framework that we kind of, our culture bequeaths to us. Mm-hmm. You know, we do that a lot. We do that when we try to even champion social justice. We fight. You know, we decide that we're fighting against. We, you know, and so we demonize the other side. It's kind of, and we tap into a part of ourselves that goes there, of an us-them mentality, which is in all of us. And then we, so that we just see replicated all over the place. The young people are just playing out what we've given them to play with. You know, so anyway, that's
well, this has been written.